Good morning, Lapine. Is everybody awake? So did anybody get to slide in today? Slide out, slide over, slide through. I got to slide the other day. It hurt. Thank the Lord we're here. Father God, in the name of Jesus, we come before you. It is an honor and a privilege to be your kid. Thank you, Lord, for letting us in your house. Thanks for not putting out the rumble strip, even though we may deserve that. But, Lord, thank you. Thank you that we get to come into your house. We get to gather in your name. We get to worship you and adore you. And, Lord, thank you for what you're doing, and thank you for why you do it. Lord, we pray that you would pour out your blessing on those who wanted to make it, but they couldn't. And we pray for those otherwise. God, we just thank you that you are in charge. You are the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. You are the Alpha, the Omega, the beginning and the end. You are the bright and morning star. And that, Lord God, that means you're our guide star. And today, Lord, guide us well. Pray that, Lord Jesus, that we would get to know you better today. And God, that we would leave with the fragrance of God upon us. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen.
Y'all ready to worship the Lord?
Blessed be your name, O Lord. Blessed be your glory. The sun sets free. Oh, it's free indeed. I'm a child of God. Yes, I am. Free at last, He has ransomed me. His grace runs deep. While I was a slave to sin, Jesus died for me. Yes, He died for me. Who the Son sets free. Oh, it's free. I'm a child of God, yes I am. In my Father's house, there's a place for me. I'm a child of God, yes I am. I am chosen, not forsaken. I am who You say I am. You are for me, not against me. I am who You say I am. I am chosen, not forsaken. I am who You say I am. You are for me. I am who You say I am. Yes, I am who You say I am. Who the sun sets free. Oh, it's free indeed. I'm a child of God. Yes, I am. In my Father.
Being free this morning. Amen. Amen. The altars are open for you to come and get prayer this morning if you need it. If you just need to lay down some burdens this morning, the altar is open for that as well. So please come and worship.
Spirit was moving over the waters. Spirit, come move over us. Come rest on us. Come rest on us. Spirit was moving over the waters. Spirit, come move over us. Come rest on us. Come rest on us. Here and I know You are more. water, Spirit, come move over us. Come rest on us. Come rest on us. Fire and wind, come and do it again. Open up the gates, let heaven on in. Come rest on us. Come rest on us. Fire and wind, come and do it again. Open up the gates, let heaven on in. Come rest on us. Come rest on us. Calm down, Spirit, when you move, you make my heart pound. When you fill the room, you're here and I know you are moving. I'm here and I know you will fill me. Calm down, Spirit, when you move, you make my heart pound. When you fill the room, you're here and I know you are moving. I'm here and I know you will fill me. Yeah. Fill us all.
Spirit was moving over the waters.
Spirit, come move over us. Come rest on us. Come rest on us. The Spirit was moving over the water. Spirit, come move over us. Come rest on us. Come rest on us. Hallelujah. Holy Lord, worthy is your name. Holy Lord, holy is your name. Holy Lord. Holy Spirit, come rest on us. You're all we want. You're all we want. Holy Spirit, come rest on us. You're all we want. Ooh. Yeah, that I was so. Yeah, that I'm a key, that I was so. Yeah, that I'm a key, that I was so. Hey, that I'm a see, that I'm a key, that I was so. Oh, Lara ki ara ra bo so. Si ara ra bo so.
Lord, we want your fragrance on us. We want you so heavenly upon, heavily upon us. That your fragrance would flow, that your the fragrance of your presence would be upon us so heavily. That God, even the people who don't know you would recognize a difference. Like Moses coming down from the mountain, he was glowing. God, we want to glow. We want to glow with your presence. We want to smell like you. We want to sound like you. We want to love like you. We want to understand like you. We want to be bold and courageous and very courageous, just like you. We want to be dread warriors like you. Holy Spirit, come rest on us. You're all we want. You're all we want. Holy Spirit, come rest on us. You're all we want. You're all we want. Oh, we love you, Lord. Oh, we love you, Lord. Let him know. Oh, we love you, Lord. Lord, I love you, Lord. I worship you, Lord. I adore you, Lord. I need you, Lord. I need you, Lord. Worthy is the Lamb. Holy is the Lamb. Awesome is the Lamb.
Holy is Lamb, amazing is Lamb, wonderful Counselor, mighty God, holy, holy, holy. Ye lara vason dariki, ye lara ki arara vason. Ye lara ki arara boson dariki, shon daraki teri bosu, khen arara boson dariki.
Lord, you are so good to us. You love to reach out your hand and touch us. You love to reach down your heart and embrace us. You love to demonstrate your compassion upon us. You love, O Lord, to love on your kids and to help them and encourage them. God, I can't thank you enough for who you are and what you do. You are so worthy to be praised. The devil offers us so much, but it's nothing compared to what you do. So God, I pray your people choose to follow you. And God, thank you. Thank you for what you are doing and why you are doing it the way you are. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Lord, you remind me at this in these times when we're moving a lot of snow and whether we successfully walk in it or not, you're the one who strengthens us. You caused your servant to be able to outrun a chariot. You caused another servant to be able to bring down an entire Colosseum. You cause your servants to do things that can't be done, even walking on water. But you cause your servants to be able to do what is super above nature. It's no different today. So God, cause us to not forget that you are super above nature. You are supernatural. You're the creator of the universe and sustainer of the whole universe. And as Shechem said, and Hamor, but Hamor said, or Shechem said, if you'll only accept me. And the devil said, if you'll only serve me, I'll give you anything you want. Well, devil, you can stick it in hell. You can go there and you can stay there. Leave us alone. The Lord rebuke you, Satan. The Lord rebuke you, Satan. The Lord rebuke you, Satan. This is a place, Lord, where you have called us in to get our healing. You've called us in to get our wisdom. You've called us in to give us insight and understanding. You've called us to get the gifts and callings of God. You've called us in to do that. And those who jump over the fence are not shepherds, but they're thieves. God, thank you for giving me the honor to be the gatekeeper here And God, thank you for letting me be a part of what you're doing. God, I don't ask you to bless what I'm doing. I ask you to keep me to do only what you want done. God, our goal is not to make people feel warm and fuzzy. Our goal is to bring a sword, a hammer, and fire so that your kids can be healthy, so that we can be who you need us to be, so we can come against the wiles of the enemy in our day. We will not step back from what you call us to do. And whatever that is, I pray we would do that well. But I pray most of all that we would follow you, Lord, with all our heart, soul, mind, body, and spirit, and even unto death, if it so be what's best. God, have your way. In Jesus' name, hallelujah. God is good, isn't he?
Amen.
He is so good. Do you know he's on your side? Even if you're on the wrong side, he's on your side. But he's not on the side of the wrong. He's on your side for what's best. Amen? Hallelujah. Thank you, worship team. You guys are awesome. I don't care what your what Armadillo said. I had to rescue Armadillo this week, Army. Yeah. Thank.
There I am. I have something to share really quick, if that's all right. All right. We still have Buddy Barrel. I know. Buddy Barrel is waving at the camera, by the way. I put his arm down and it popped right back up. So I just felt like I was supposed to share. Some ladies and I were talking this last week, and it feels like the enemy is attacking a lot of people in our congregation. Does anyone else feel that way? I think it's important for us to remember that if the enemy is attacking us, it's because we're doing what God wants us to do and he doesn't want us to do it, right? So we were talking about Paul and how he wrote in, what was it, Ephesians or Galatians? In the Bible. He wrote it in the Bible. Right, in the New Testament. So when he's going through tribulations and trials, he counts it as joy. And I've been pondering that this week because I don't really feel like being joyful when the enemy is attacking me. It doesn't feel good when thing after thing keeps coming up and happening that I don't feel like should be happening, right? But I think it all has to do with your attitude and your perspective, right? Because no matter how much the enemy attacks you, one, we know he's attacking because he doesn't want you to be effective for God's kingdom. And two, he's attacking you and wanting you to be negative about your trials because other people are watching you trying to figure out, okay, you profess to be a Christian now, so how are you going to deal with this? Are you going to deal with it like the world deals with it? Or are you going to have a different attitude? And that's kind of what I've been pondering this week. It kind of went along with some stuff that was prayed this morning. So I felt like someone needed to hear that to count it all joy doesn't mean that we're happy about what's happening to us in our lives. It means we choose to have an attitude of no matter what happens, God is my Savior. Jesus is my Savior, and I will be with him one day in heaven. It doesn't matter what happens on this earth. We will be with him one day in heaven, right? Amen.
Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. That was good. That's a good word. Good word. Amen. Good word. So, Buddy Barrel.
Wait, before Buddy Barrel, can I do my couple announcements and then that so I can leave with the kids? Is that okay?
You can't leave with the kids until Buddy Barrel's done.
Exactly. Yeah, so a couple announcements. First, today after service, if you have any teenagers that are going to be involved in Amplify this year, which is our fine arts festival, we're having a meeting with a light lunch in the back room. And we're just going to be going over what Amplify is, what it entails, what financially that means, and answer all the questions you might have about Amplify. If you are interested at all, please come. Also, if you have a talent, a creative talent in singing or instruments or art or anything.
I do puppets.
I don't think we have anyone wanting to learn puppets. So please come to the meeting as well, because you may be able to help our team out. If you, and then that's it. That's all I'm going to say about that. So please come right after church to the fellowship hall. We'll be meeting back there. And then number two.
Terry, would you switch screens, please?
Thank you all for being patient with our family as we had a really busy January so far. Christmas is still up, as you can see. And we are going to be taking Christmas down from the church Tuesday after Ladies' Coffee.
You can't take Christmas down from the church.
Okay, Christmas decorations are going to be put away.
Because isn't everything we do about Christ Mass?
Okay, you're really taking it a little too far. Okay, so Christmas.
Well, it's about Christ gathering, Christ Mass.
Do you want this to be done?
It's a Christ Mass.
Do you want this to be done?
Christ Mass is all the time.
So Tuesday, Ladies' Coffee is at 10 a.m., and as soon as we're done visiting and fellowshipping, we will get Christmas decorations put away. That's my announcements. Oh, and thank you to everyone who was able to support Sam in his play.
Woohoo!
Right? If you did not get to come to the play, I have a YouTube link for the last performance. If you would like to watch it at home, I can send you that YouTube link. It was amazing.
It was great.
These kids worked super hard, and this theater company, it was not a Christian production, obviously, Seven Brides for Seven Brothers, but the whole cast.
They had a parson.
They did have a parson.
Yeah.
So the cast and the crew and the directors and the choreographers and everyone who worked with those kids, it's a Christian community. And so it was super cool to get to watch these kids grow and treat each other with Christ's love throughout all the practices and everything. It was so fun to get to be a part of. So I think Sam wants.
Well, welcome back. Is the iPad music or sound still on? Good. Cool.
All right.
So the title today is, what are you trying to prove to God in 2024? It was kind of a unique thing as I was in prayer and intercession, and the Lord put this on my heart. What are you trying to prove to God? You know, so many times people are trying to prove this, and they're trying to prove that, and they're trying to prove whatever. But there, in my worship mix that I made, wow, long time ago, I think it was in 03 or 08, but in a worship mix that I made, this is the very first song in it. And this, the reason that this remains the first song is because this is centering. This is centering back on what is important. So be mindful of, what are you trying to prove to God? And just listen. The lyrics will come up on the screen. But listen and pay attention if you would, please.
It's all about you, Jesus, and all this is for your glory and your faith. It's not about me, as if you should do things my way. You alone are God, and I surrender to your will.
Let yourself just center in and listen.
Jesus, lover of my soul, all-consuming fire is in your gaze. Jesus, I want you to know I will follow you all my days. For no one else in history is like you, and history itself belongs to you. Alpha and Omega, you have loved me, and I will share eternity with you. It's all about you, Jesus, and all this is it's not about me, as if you should do things my way. You alone are God, and I surrender. I surrender, God. It's all.
It's not about me, as if you should do things my way. You alone are God, and I surrender to your
So the question comes up, what are you trying to prove to God? Is it your dedication? Are you trying to prove to God your education? Are you trying to prove to God or others, but are you trying to prove to God, you don't get to see that yet, quit going ahead. Or are you trying to prove to God your dedication, or are you just living it out? Are you trying to prove to God your education? Well, I know all this. Do you think at any point in time, now obviously if you're sincere, but do you think at any point in time God is impressed with what you know compared to what he knows? God cares, right? He says, be a studier of the word so that you can rightly divide it and you're not made a fool of. But God, are you trying to prove to God how much education you have? Are you trying to prove to God how much edification you have? How good you are at puffing people up? Are you trying to prove to God your ability to disseminate? I put dissemination, not sure if that's a word. But are you trying to prove to God that you can tell the world his words? I'm going to get ahead of myself. I'll stop there. Are you trying to prove to God that your emancipation? And you might go, well, that's kind of weird. I'm old enough to be emancipated. But are you emancipated from sin? Are you trying to prove to God you're emancipated from sin? Or are you just being? Which is it? Are you trying to be impressive? Oh, here's a good one. Are you trying to prove to God your perfunctification? Now, I know what it is to perfunctigate. I'm not sure if there's a perfunctication, but I do know this. I have the microphone and you don't, so I get to say it. All it means is your ability to speak, your ability to share, your ability to get across something. Are you trying to prove to God what an orator you are? Remember the old days? And God said, da, 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 da. Do you know why they used oratory like that? Because they didn't have sound systems. How else are you going to get it out there, right? Man, some of those old places, they had these pulpits that were up on staircases and you had to go up and you were way out over the, kind of centered in the crowd, way out over, or you were maybe sometimes off to the side on some of those cathedrals. Anyways, but you're way out and up. You know why? Because your voice carries. So they had to use oratory. But your ability to speak does not denote your sincerity. You'll see that in a moment. What about, are you trying to prove to God your sanctification? That you are sanctified and holy. Well, I hope you're sanctified and holy for sure. But are you trying to prove it to God? And worse, are you trying to prove it to others? Or are you just sanctified and holy as you're following the Lord? Are you trying to prove to God your ability to memorize his word and using addresses and phone numbers? I call them. That's the verse and the chapters. The chapters and the verses. Are you trying to be impressive like that? Noel Webster could quote the Bible chapter and verse all the way through. But you know why that's not so impressive to God, even though he might have been a good guy? I have no idea. But you know what I know? I know a lot of people in my life. I've been around a lot of people in my life that can speak chapter and verses, but they don't know what they mean. So your memorization is only as good as, do you know what he meant by what he said, or are you just good at quoting numbers? The other, are you trying to prove to God that you are blessed because you have monetization? Now, some of you know that term because you're online, and you know what it is to be monetized. If you have a YouTube page, if you have, you know, these different things, are you getting monetized? Did you know that having riches does not confirm your salvation or even how well you follow the Lord? Do you know how I know that? Because the Taj Mahal blows away a lot of Christian buildings, right? There's a whole lot of stuff that are built to false gods that make a lot of the Christian buildings look like garbage. And one of the things I've noticed around this region is, well, we have asphalt, therefore we are godly. That's a bunch of baloney. It's a bunch of asphalt. Don't overdo that. Are you trying to prove to God your preservation? Look, God, I preserve, I endure, God, do you not see that? Can I just tell you, unless the Lord guards the city, you stay awake in vain, right? Do you try to impress God with your spiritual enculturation? Do you know the church cliches? Do you know that, do you wear your hair just the right way? Do you wear just the right shoes? Do you wear the right pants or the right dress or the right skirt or the right blouse or the right? Now, please, by all means, I am very much into you cover yourself so that you're not advertising things that only your spouse should ever see. But my point is your spiritual enculturation. Are you trying to prove to God, oh God, I can say all of the things that are churchy? I can't think of any right now, or I'd give you an example because I'm not into it. You know, it's like. There's a lot of things over the years that have been so important to some. You know, back in the day, there was the holiness movement, and that was, oh, you better, you know, you girls better make sure you're only wearing dresses, and you guys better make sure you're only wearing pants. You know, what's really funny is back in Jesus' day, they wore togas, the guys. That's a dress, but, you know, I'm not saying don't do that. God does say in his word, it is inappropriate and against his word for a man to try to look like a woman or a woman to try to look like a man. But during the holiness movement, you ladies that have pale lips couldn't put on any paint to make your lips show up. Now, don't take that personal. But the point is, and you couldn't wear dangly things, and you couldn't do this, and you couldn't do that. And it's the same today. We have these cultures that just aren't in the Bible. And if you think you are, you know, oh, I won't go there, because then I'm going to start screaming. Oh, I came up with another word. I don't know if it's real, but I got the mic. Are you trying to prove God your holinization? Holinization. You've been holinized. Are you trying to prove to God that you're holy? Or are you just being holy? What are you trying to prove to God in 2024? Because if you're trying to prove it to God, I guarantee you, you're trying to prove it to others, or you're making a rule or a church culture about it and calling it the Bible. And Jesus said, you know, you're really good at making up your own rules and ignoring what I said, which was have compassion, not sacrifice. Some of us, for me, a sacrifice would be putting on hair. I am not putting on hair for you guys, just so you know. I am happy with the way God made my head. God made a few perfect heads and he put hair on the rest of y'all. At least that's what they say. But holinization is, wow, you know, oh man, that person comes in and they got the, you know, they just look the part and they're just the right colors and, oh man, they wear the right shirts and they wear the right, and they got dangly things and they got gold bracelets and they got, you know, and I used to wear some of that stuff because I was in business and I did well and used to wear real nice tie bars and cost me a lot of money. And you know what really stinks is when you lose one of those. I have searched entire stock rooms for one of my tie bars once because it was worth it. Are you trying to prove your humiliation? Are you trying to prove you're truly humble? We'll talk about that in a little bit. Are you trying to prove that you're willing to have the demonstration of the Lord in your life? Here's something. I think I'm just being ahead of myself here. Did you know the ability to speak in tongues doesn't mean you're mature? Did you know your ability to quote verses doesn't mean you're mature? Did you know that if you can pray in big, flowery, oh, God, if only you would perpetuate over all of my sins, I'm so grateful for that, and you use all these big words. Do you know that doesn't mean you're godly? It just means you're good at saying certain words. In case you're not sure about that, Hitler was a perfunctigator. Hitler was a wordsmith. Hitler was able to get people to do what he wanted because he could spin it and make everybody in the room feel so warm and cuddly. And if they wouldn't, then he'd just kill them. Did you know that about him? So when somebody is sticking their silver tongue in your ear, grab their tongue and just pull down as hard as you can. I know, you're seeing the picture, you're like, that's mean. No, man, if they're trying to stick their silvery tongue in your ear, just grab their tongue and pull down. And they probably won't do it to you again. Okay, let's move on. Let's not do that. Okay, we did the song. Come on. Move on. Luke 18. Start verse 9. First of all, we'll read it. Also, to some who are relying on their own righteousness. The word righteousness is that you are right with God, or that you are in alignment, that you are right where you ought to be. True righteousness is acknowledging that God has a right to tell you what to do, when to do it, how to do it, and what are the rules, and who and who's a boy and who's a girl, and on and on and on and on. And do you know why God has a right to tell you anything he wants? Because in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. It's all his. He owns it, sustains it, he rules it, and he named everything for what it is. But some people relying on their own righteousness and looking down on everyone else, on their own ability to come into righteousness with God, come into alignment with God. The people who say they can do it on their own, and they look down on you. So the Lord speaks a parable about that, because self-righteousness causes people to run. Self-righteousness keeps people from being able to find Christ through you, because you are making it clear that it is your righteousness, it is your way of thinking, that you're saying, I'm as good as it gets with God. And by the way, Jesus told a parable. What's a parable? You might not know the word. A parable was a simple saying. A very, 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 very simplified saying, so that people who didn't understand God's word would totally get it. The reason the parables were important was because the highly religious people didn't like parables, because they didn't get it, because Jesus wasn't willing to speak in a high language, a religious language. He was willing to tell stories in such a simple way that all of us simple people got it. And the highly religious people were offended, because they're like, oh, you're not speaking the way we want you to talk. Because if you were really godly, you'd talk like us. If you want to see something funny, look at all the old Christian movies. The old ones, the black and whites. And stuff since, you know, some of those. Weren't they all in King James English? I'm not kidding. If you look at the one, there's one about Martin Luther. And, I mean, they're all like, oh, and all, you know. And it's really funny. There's a few others, obviously. I just think that's so funny. It's like, you know, they should be speaking Hebrew. But anyways. So Jesus tells this parable about those who were self-righteous. They thought they could get to heaven their way. They thought they could become just like God and be in line with God by their way of doing it. And they were looking down on everybody else like, you are below me. I had a friend not very long ago who said, we were joking around, and he said, I'm just trying to, what was that? I'm just trying to follow your shadow. Well, he's this much taller than me. I said, you couldn't do that unless you were on a ladder. Anyway, or unless I'm on a ladder. That's what I meant. Anyways, so it'd be like, you know, I'm down here, he's up here. Can't get under my shadow. But at the point, something the Lord told me years ago was this. Don't ever get to the point, that's what he said. Don't ever let yourself get to the point where you feel like everybody else ought to be groveling at your feet or giving you something. Never let yourself get to the point where you feel like you've done so much in God that everybody ought to be like, oh, wow, look who walked into the room. Wow, ooh. Instead, just be a follower, right? Instead, just be a child of God. Don't try to prove. He goes on to say, two men went up to the temple to pray. One was a Pharisee, The other was a despised tax collector. So a Pharisee, just so you know, just giving you a little lesson. A Pharisee was a follower. They were a conservative, generally a conservative follower. of the Word of God, a Sadducee was the ruling class of priests and leaders, and they were put in place by Rome. Just always remember, a Sadducee is Sadducee because they don't believe in the work of the Holy Spirit, they don't believe in angels, and they don't believe in the rapture. That's why they're sad. They have no hope. And there's a lot of Sadducees in this world. But praise God, we're growing. Anyways, but a Pharisee, some Pharisees were good, some were not. But a Pharisee who was self-righteous and a tax collector go to the temple to pray. Now you got to remember, the tax collectors were despised because they were Jews that would rat out their brothers and sisters in Judaism so they could make money at it. There's a lot more to say about that. So the Pharisee stood and prayed to himself, "Oh God, I thank you that I am not like the rest of these greedy, dishonest, immoral suckers, or like this despised tax collector. I fast twice a week." So he skips two meals. Whoopee ding, right? "I pay tithes on my entire income." Do you know that the ability to pay tithes, or how people tithe, does not denote how godly they are? Something God put on my heart a long, long, long time ago was never look or try hard to never know what people give. And the reason why is because if one person gives $1,000 a month and another gives $5 a month, it doesn't, but maybe the one given $1,000 is a millionaire and the one giving $5 a month only made $10. How much you give does not denote your maturity. Tithes means 10%, in case you ever wondered that. Anyways, but here's the tax collector. He's despised. He knows he's got a horrible job. Sometimes they weren't even giving a choice. Is the Romans came to them and said, "You, go collect taxes from your Jewish brothers. And if you said, I don't want to, they could have you beaten, imprisoned, or killed." So you tended to go, and if you really pushed hard, they could kill your family or imprison your family. So anyways, what would happen is they'd go, "Okay." And then we know Zacchaeus is the next story in this whole thing. But is that a lot of them became wealthy because they had the Roman authority so if you owed $20, they could tax you $40. Of course, it was different money, right? They would tax you twice as much if they wanted to. And if you complained, they could have you beaten, put in prison, or killed. And there's nothing you could do. So, this despised tax collector, who, as the Lord is talking about, has come to the Lord and is repenting. He's standing a long ways off at the temple grounds. He didn't even raise his eyes towards heaven, but he just said, "Oh God, have mercy on me, the sinner that I am." And you may misunderstand the word sinner or mercy. Mercy is favor you don't deserve, and sinner is doing things in ways God would not. But you know what? Because God has mercy on you and had mercy on him, he was able, I need to read that part. Jesus says, "I tell you, this man," the tax collector, "went home, down to his house, right with God, in alignment with God, rather than that religious guy. For everyone who exalts himself will be made humbled." And there's a difference. This is it. When God humbles you, he takes you down to where you're really at the bottom. But he says, "But everyone who chooses to humble themselves will be exalted." Humility is strength under control. Humility is not simplest, being simple, which is, in other words, naive. Humility is not being a weakling. Humility is not being somebody who lets themselves be pushed around. Humility is, "I know who I am, but I choose to not either defend or do what I need to, what I feel like doing. Or say what I want to say, but I let God speak through me because I recognize I don't know enough to be able to help people in their time of need. Do you know when people are attacking you and you're a Christian or you're walking with the Lord well and somebody's attacking you? Do you know they're not attacking you? You know that, right? They're throwing darts at a picture of you, but it's Jesus behind it. Remember, they're attacking Christ. They're putting themselves in jeopardy. They're putting themselves at risk. And if they continue, they will be humbled by the Lord. He will put them down the way that needs to happen, not maybe the way. Matthew 20:16 tells us the first will be last and the last will be first. What that means is those who are proving themselves, those who are trying to look good, those that are trying to be shiny, those that say, well, you know, everybody ought to do it my way or the highway and so on. But the first, those who think themselves first, will be last in God's kingdom. But those who choose to not care what place they're in, the last, will be first when God blesses, when God helps, when God, But at the end of things, at the end of all things, those who thought they were in first place will be in last place. And those who thought they were in last place because they, honestly, it comes from not caring. It really comes from not caring what place you're in. Because honestly, what place do you want to be in God's kingdom? I want to grab his leg. I want to sit on his foot and I want to grab his leg really hard. And I want to ride on Jesus' foot. Because that's something I loved as a kid and didn't get to do it much. Still want to do it with Jesus. And you know what? I don't care what place that puts me in. The only thing I want, when I found out that the scripture says in Revelation that if you'll follow me with all of your heart and lead well, if you'll do these things in a certain way, then I will let you sit next to me, not necessarily right hand, but I'm going to let you sit with me at my throne area, and you get to, and what it comes down to is I'm like, ooh, I want to be there because I want to watch how he does his job. I want to watch him use his power. The Lord said this, those who are first amongst you are servant of all. Not the ones who do it with their lips, the ones who do it with their life. So what are you trying to prove? One of our other favorite songs. And you can sing along, because I'm going to try to. I love this song. Who am I that the Lord of all the earth would care to know my name, would care to feel my hurts? Who am I that the bright and morning star would choose to light the way for my ever-wandering heart? Not because of who I am, but because of what you've done. Not because of what I've done, but because of who you are. I am a flower quickly fading, here today and gone tomorrow, wave tossed in the ocean, a vapor in the wind. Still you hear me when I'm calling, Lord, you catch me when I'm falling. You told me who I am. I am yours. So whose are we? Whose are we? Because that matters, doesn't it? Whose are we? You know, when I fell the other day out here by the plow truck, it hurt so bad. But it didn't make me stop knowing whom I belong to. Amen? When you're working for the Lord and somebody pukes on stop knowing who you are, right? It is a thing that our culture is saying when you're going through hardship, you need to question who you are and what is your value. That's satanic. I'm not kidding. So many people are going, I stubbed my toe and I was wondering if God loved me anymore. Stop it. Amen. You're going to stub your toe. You're going to get hurt once in a while. People are going to bleh on you. You can say that in church. That's not a cuss word yet. But who are you? You are a child of God. You are a child of God Most High. You are part of a royal priesthood. Don't take a back seat to the enemy. Don't let it happen. Before I get to this, to what end are you trying to prove anything to God? As if to be revered by God. Do you know that the Lord doesn't look at anybody differently? Except those who are broken and contrite and tremble at his word. That's the only ones he looks to differently. Everybody else, y'all are equals. We're all equals. But if we'll be broken and contrite and tremble at his word, and we might touch enough of that today to get it. But here's the thing we got to remember is that you are not impressed by God. God doesn't look at you and go, wow. Instead, he goes, oh, that's my kid. Get over here. Right? On your best day, he goes, oh, you did so good doing what I asked. You didn't bring, you know, and the Bible tells us you don't bring any value to the kingdom that's not already inherently there. You can, if you brought diamonds to heaven, you would not add 1 ounce of value to the kingdom of God. If you were a bazillionaire, God doesn't love you any more than if you've got minus $10,000 or $1 million or whatever it is. He doesn't care what you have. He doesn't care what you bring to the table. He only cares that you come to the table. You come to the throne room of grace. You find mercy and grace to help in your time of need. That's what he cares about. You are the most important asset in the kingdom of God. Not the buildings, not your cars, not your houses, not your umbrella. Or whether you got a cool watch or you don't have a cool watch or you got a cool phone or you don't have a cool phone. Who cares? Do you know what I know? The cooler things you have, the more distraction you got. It's a fact. Be careful what you allow to take away from your relationship and your time with God. It may be a okay thing, but it may not be the best thing for you. And I'll just say this while I'm on it, because this is a problem around the world. Make sure you're using your screen time timers on your stupid smartphones. I have stupid smartphones too. But I pay attention to my screen timer. And when it comes up and it says, last week, you were 2.4 hours less than the week before, I'm like, yes! If you don't use those timers, you're probably, much like a lot of people around the world, that we get those videotapes where you're walking along and you're falling into things. All I ask is, before you do, have somebody else record you. I want to see it. I'm not kidding. I really want to see you do that. Because that's funny. Luke 18. Yeshua, that's Jesus in Hebrew, by the way, right? It's Yahweh who saves. Yeshua approached Jericho. That Jericho, the J is the Y, but anyways. A blind man was sitting by the road begging. When he heard the crowd going past, he asked what it was all about. And they told him, Yeshua, or Jesus from Nazareth, is passing by. And he calls out, Yeshua, son of David, have pity on me. Wouldn't you? Wouldn't you do that? Why do we have prayer times? Why do we have you come up? Because it's biblical. It's right. The Bible says if any are sick amongst you, call in the elders of the church that they would anoint with oil and pray, and that sick person will be made well. It's a done thing. Amen? And he's just saying, help! You ever heard anybody cry for help that needed it? I have. And I've cried for help when I needed it. One time I was elk hunting in around Waldport, and I'm bushwhacking straight up this hill because I went straight down one hill or down into the ravine, and then I went straight up the other side because I didn't want to get lost, honestly. And I stepped up, and when I stepped up onto this log, I stepped up and it gave way. And it was slick, and I began to fall backwards. I had my friend's 7mm, and it had an expensive scope, really, really nice gun. He was a gunsmith. I had that on my back, and funny thing is, I was more worried that I was going to break his scope that probably cost more than my car and his gun, honestly. And I'm like, and I yelled out, Jesus! And the Spirit said, just reach forward and grab. There was a limb in the bush, and I grabbed, and I don't remember what my angle was, but I was back a pretty good ways. I grabbed and pulled myself up, and as soon as I got straight up, the limb went, snapped right off. It was another dead tree inside there with a limb sticking out, and God made it so the limb held me up, got me up, and then it snapped off. And I must have let out a pretty good yell because my friend at the top of the ravine, he goes, you okay, Norm? Yeah. Well, what happened? I'll tell you when I get up there. Because I was just like going, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Because I would have got hurt. It was actually a pretty good fall. It would have been. Give him glory. Yeshua approached Jericho. Yeah, blind man. He's sitting there. Yeshua, son of David, have pity on me. And it goes on to say, those in front of the crowd, those, and in one of the Gospels, it says, the other Talmudim or the other followers of Jesus, they ordered him to shut up. Can you imagine your kid crying out for help? And other people around don't realize it's your kid. And they're crying out for help. And you say, shut up. You don't qualify, you brat. You're not dressed the way you should be. Or you're blind. You're a beggar. What do you matter? But the owner of the child, the creator of the child, the one who loves him more than anybody ever could, says, excuse me. And stops and says, bring him to me. Bring me my son. We don't see that in the words, but that's what's happening. The creator of this child, the creator of this man who was born blind, the creator of him is the Lord. And the Lord says, bring him here. And I love what the Lord says. He goes, hey, what do you want me to do for you? Do you know that's important? Because sometimes we just got a headache. God help my head. Whatever it is. But Jesus, the most important part of this passage is that Jesus stopped, that he said, bring him here. He ordered them to bring him to him. He didn't go, oh, I hear somebody, but it really doesn't matter. But you see, this man was honestly, sincerely, and humbly calling out to the Lord with all of his heart. That's what made the difference. Because he was saying, Jesus, son of David, which is a designation of not just his kingship, but also as son of David, Christ, the one who is the Christ, help, I believe in you. That's really what's going on here. Of course, Jesus said, what do you want me to do? The blind man says, let me be able to see. Yeshua says to him, see again. Your trust has healed you. Instantly he received his sight and began following him, glorifying God. When all the people saw it, they too praised God. The word here in the complete Jewish Bible of trust is the same in many other versions, is faith. I like the word trust there, because if you trust the Lord, you'll receive from him. When I was falling backwards off that log, and I demonstrated, but I got hurted the other day. Anyways, as I was, and it was about that good of a step, as I was falling backwards, and I mean, the Lord just, in my heart, I don't think it was audibly, it couldn't have been any louder, and he said, reach out and grab and pull yourself up. And I reached out blindly. I couldn't see it because I was too much of an angle. And I reached out and grabbed something, and it pulled me up, and then it snapped off. That's what God wants you to do. Trust him. Trust him to put what you need where he can put it and nobody else. Amen? Let's get this done. We already talked about that. So one of the things, just as a correction to us all, is we watch a clock instead of listening to and anticipating God Almighty to move on us. Don't be that person. Now, I get it. We have timelines. I get it. You know, it was kind of fun when I was in Uganda. I got to preach. Sunday school was 3 hours minimum. They didn't tell me. They just kept telling me to keep going. I was like, okay. I mean, I fit right in. I'm like, man, I could talk forever. It was awesome, though, because we could actually go deep enough to make a difference. We didn't watch clocks there. Don't be a clock watcher. Be a God watcher. Instead of listening to and anticipating God Almighty to move on us, we need God to move upon us, don't we? We need him to move upon us. Another one of my favorite songs. This is another one that's actually part of my worship mix, worship intercession mix. It's called Break Our Hearts. Because we need our hearts broken before God so that those around us can see God for who he is. Amen? But when we're focused on our stuff, they can't. Can I have that up, please? Oh, God. If you know it, sing. Hearts. Break our hearts. Oh, God. Break our hearts for the sin in our lives. Break our hearts for the sin in our land. Break our hearts. We cry out, we need your help. Come back to our land. We confess, we lived in sin. Please show your power once again. So you get the point. We need God to break our hearts. We need God to break our hearts of the callousness. I like what the guy said years ago. I can't think of his name right now. But you'll remember him maybe. As he says, God, give me baby skin. God, I need baby skin. In fact, one of my favorite songs, he says, oh, Lord, you're beautiful. Your face is all I see, and when your eyes are on this child, your grace abounds to me. And if I'm doing well, help me to never seek a crown, just to live it, Lord. It's so important. What did you come to see? When you come to church, what do you come to see? What do you come to get? As the Lord talked about John the Baptist, did you come to see a reed shaken by the wind? Somebody who would cower to your way that you want it said or your way you want it done? I like John. He's wearing camel skin and he's eating stuff nobody wants. Chocolate covered, probably not chocolate covered, but grasshopper. Mmm, they're so crunchy. Not that I've had one. It does seem like I've had a chocolate-covered one. Maybe it was an ant. I was going for tarantula once, and they wouldn't let me. It's right up there with broccoli for some of you guys. But what did you come to see? Did you come to see God? Did you come to see a reed shaken by the wind that's willing to bow to your preferences, your wants, your desires, your enculturation? Or will you be bowed to the one, the Lord? If you came and you haven't changed in this moment to bow to the one that you should bow to, the Lord God Almighty, shame on you, and may it never be. One of my other favorite songs says, open up your cries of mercy, send down your cleansing flood. Healing waters rise around us. Hear our cries, Lord, let them rise. What is your cry? Is your cry, God, do it my way? Come on, God, will you do it my way? Come on, God, would you sing my song? Come on, God, would you have them wear what I want them to wear? Come on, God, would you have the lights my way? Come on, God, would you have the whatever? Or are you saying, God, I want to come to be with you? One of the scriptures says, it says, be careful how you approach the house of God, to approach, to listen, not to be heard or to have it your way. What are you trying to prove to God? Because if you're coming with your preferences over God's move upon your heart, then what you're literally doing is you're saying, God, you don't know what you're doing. If I'm going to be religious, if I'm going to follow you, then you better move the way I want you to move. You better have your people clothed the way I think they ought to be clothed. You better have the colors the way I want to have it. You better have the screen the right size and the right shape. You better get done on time, oh God. You better, you better, you better. I don't know about you, but if somebody was talking like that audibly next to me, I'd be like, hey, You just stay right there. Okay. Go ahead. Wouldn't it be awesome? Wouldn't that be fun? Come on. I'm telling you. The only thing that would be better is if God gives you a spiritual paintball gun and you get to mark them for it. Ding, 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 ding. Is that not fun? Nobody? I mean, some of you guys are like, yeah. But seriously, they're not just like me. I'm so glad you guys are not like me. You got way too many hairs, most of you. But not just that. The reason we can reach the world is because we're different like the world is. And though we're in the world, but we're not of the world. But, you know, those with ZZ Top beards can talk to other people with cool beards. And those who have experiences and whatever your experiences are, you can talk to people that might not talk to me. And I've tried the drugs and the alcohol. I've done the biking. I've done a lot of really interesting things. And I've done stuff I'll never tell you. Because that's between me and God. So, by the way, I don't want to fit into your mold. I don't care who you are. I don't care what you're paying. I don't care how you could influence. My goal is not to be another you. No offense, but I'm just talking about the ones that are eating Ipecac. I want to come to church to find God. I want to come to church to glorify the Lord. The first song I ever sang as a solo publicly, and I did it intentionally. I was 17 at the time, and God has given me a big set of lungs. But I remember just part of the song. Lord, I'll praise you because of who you are, not for all the mighty deeds that you have done. And it goes on. And I belted it out. And everybody went, who are you? And where did you learn to sing like that? But you see, I was singing for the Lord. I was doing it for him. I wasn't doing it for them. But the cool thing is, it turned out that some people liked it. I'll bet there were some people going, dude, that's like the scratch in the chalkboard. I don't care. Now, don't get me wrong. If I'm being stupid, I care. But, I mean, I care that I was being stupid. But if I'm doing what God wants me to do and you don't like how I do it, I can always pump gas. Do you see what I'm saying? That's what my pastor for years said all the time. He goes, you know what? I can just go pump gas. Because the reality is that this is a honor and a privilege and a blessing and something I'm told to do. God told me to come here. But you know what? At the end of the day, you're not my boss. You don't own me. Well, we pay you. No, you don't. God does. And if you take away what God has told me to receive, that's between you and God. Because I can go do something else and you get to deal with him. But my point is that did you come to be heard? Did you come to be seen? Did you come to have your way? Did you come to be, oh, geez, pastor, you know, you should have been done, you know, I don't know when, because actually, who knows. But the point is, did you come to meet with God? Did you come to get the fragrance of God? Or did you come to hear something so you can walk out being religious? Ugh. Or holy, though, and in God's way. There is right religion, don't get me wrong. But did you come to have your religious niche filled, scratched? Your religious ego scratched? Or did you come to let God touch you? So that you can leave better than you came in. I hope you came that God could touch you so your life would be better. And when you go out, you'll spill that all over everybody else as a contagious Christian. Did you come to get the fragrance of God on you? I have one more song. And I picked this one on purpose. She does a great job of bringing it out. Kind of starts a little bit soft. And it's another song I love so much.
We are hungry. We are hungry for more of you. We are thirsty, oh Jesus. We are thirsty for more of you.
John, can you bring down the lights, please?
Hungry. We are.
You can stand if you want. You can sing along if you want. But let's get the fragrance of God on us.
We are thirsty, ah, Jesus. We are thirsty for more of you. Yes, Lord. Yeah. Yes, Lord. I want more of you. Living water rain down on me. Lord, I need more of you. Living breath of life, come fill me up. Lord, I want more of you. Living breath, rain down on me. Lord, I need more of you. Living breath of life, come fill me up. We are hungry. We are hungry. We are hungry for more of you. We are thirsty, oh Jesus. We are thirsty for more of you. We are hungry. We are hungry. We are hungry for more of you. We are thirsty, oh Jesus. We are thirsty for more of you. More of you. Yes. Oh, we want more of you, Lord. Yes, more of you, Lord. Need more of you. Living breath of life, come fill me up. Lord, I want more of you. Holy Spirit, rain down on me. Lord, I need more of you. Living breath of life, come fill me up. We are hungry. We are hungry. We are hungry for more of you. We are thirsty, oh Jesus. We are thirsty for more of you. We are hungry. We are hungry. We are hungry for more of you. We are thirsty, oh Jesus. We are thirsty for more of you. Sia la la voco da resi. E la la chi te le voce. Yes, Lord. More of you, Lord. More of you, Lord. More of you, Lord. God, we need more of you. We need your presence for healing. We need more of you. We need you to flow through our veins. We need more of you. We want to touch you. We lift our voices higher and higher and higher to you. We lift our holy hands up. We want to touch you. We lift our voices higher and higher, higher to you. Yes. We lift our holy hands up. We want to touch you. We lift our voices higher and higher, higher to you. We lift our holy hands up. We want to touch you. We lift our voices higher and higher, higher to you. We lift our holy hands up. We want to touch you. We lift our voices higher and higher, higher to you. We lift our holy hands up. We want to touch you. We lift our voices higher and higher, higher to you. We lift our holy hands up. We want to touch you. We are thirsty, oh Jesus. We are thirsty for more of you. Yes. God, come in your power. God, come in your strength. God, we need a healing touch. God, we need your healing presence. God, we need you. Lord, I need you. Lord, I need your touch. Lord, I need your wisdom, your discernment, your understanding, Lord. I need you, Lord. More than ever before, I need you. Ooh, yes, Lord. Yes. So we lift our holy hands up. We want to touch you. We lift our voices hands up. We want to touch you. I want to touch you, Lord. Yeah, la kiara de vosso. And higher to you. We lift our holy hands up. We want to touch you. We lift our voices higher and higher, higher to you. We lift our holy hands up. We want to touch you. We lift our voices higher and higher, higher to you. We lift our adorable soul. Lord, I would rather spend 10 minutes and 37 seconds in worship of you. John, you can keep the volume down lower just a little bit in there. Keep it on, though. A little more. I'd rather spend time in the Lord's presence any day than in a doctor's office. I would rather spend more time in God's presence than in the post office or the DMV. I would rather spend more time with God than my drive to Bend. I'd rather spend more time with the Lord in His presence than doing anything else.
Because in his presence is where there is joy, where there is breakthrough, where there is salvation, where there is wisdom. In his presence and in his word, that's where strength is received. And we can truly be humble and contrite and tremble at his word. Because the more of his word we know experientially by waiting in his presence, after, especially after reading his word or preparing for his word, then we hear things that are inexpressible. And it changes us beyond the comprehension of anyone. It brings the change we need. Lord, forgive us when we'll sit longer for a sitcom or for a video or reading something than we will for your presence. We trade one for the other if we're not careful. Lord, you remind me the old adage we had in business. What you feed will grow. If we feed to our carnal man, doing carnal things, doing things the way man would in sometimes evil or just wrong ways, that will grow. But if we feed ourselves on your presence and your word, then we will grow in your strength and in your word, and we'll become mature in you, and we'll quit trying to prove ourselves to you or anybody else. And we'll quit putting parameters on them like they did to blind Bartimaeus, and they said, you need to shut up. He's with us. You're not qualified. Honestly, he was probably a filthy beggar because the people weren't doing what they should in helping him to be well taken care of as the scripture told him to do. Interesting. Maybe they didn't want him to be close to Jesus because he would kind of tell on them that they hadn't been doing what they should have been according to the word of God. So they were trying to keep him from the rabbi who would likely and did correct them for that. So thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, that you correct those who are trying to enculturate us to be like them when you're saying, I just want you to be like me. So, Lord, thank you for letting us get some of your fragrance on us. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. We love and adore you. We praise you. We thank you. We glorify you. We magnify you. We lift you up, O God, because you're worthy. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Father. Hallelujah. As the old song said, better is one day in your courts than a thousand elsewhere. And it reminds me about the same era was a song, I want to be a history maker in this land. God, if you'll work with us, all of us, you'll make history through us. This northwest region of the United States is in desperate need of your presence. Not a desperate need of us being ourselves and having it our way. Lord, I pray anybody that's here in the sound of my voice, whether by video or here live, God, I pray that if they need you as Lord and Savior, that Lord, that you'd minister to them right now. Hallelujah. That they'd be hungry for you. Thank you, Lord. The Lord, that they would take these steps of salvation, that they would admit that they're a sinner, that they would repent of those ways, that they would believe in Jesus and the resurrection that you raised from the dead, and confess it with their mouth and call upon your name. For there is none righteous, not even one. For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. Therefore, we need to repent and return so that our sins may be wiped away in order that times of refreshing may come from the presence of the Lord. But we must repent. Without repentance, we have no salvation. Romans 6:23, the wages of sin is death. That's what we've been paying into before we came to Christ. But the free gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus, our Lord. We can say this together, can't we? John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. And by the way, Jesus didn't come so you could be religious. Jesus came so you could have right religion. What does he say? That's taking care of true widows and orphans in their times of need. But there is true religion with God. But he said, I didn't come even to bring peace, but a sword. Amen? So important. He didn't send his Son to condemn the world or you or I, but that the world through him might be saved. That if you confess with your mouth Jesus is your Lord and believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, you will be saved by that confession. For with the heart a person believes, resulting in righteousness. With the mouth he confesses, resulting in salvation. For whoever will call on the name of the Lord will be saved. And that whoever is whoever. It's whoever you is, just as you are right now. If you walked in and you were a horrible person, if you walked in and you had a fight on your way to church, if you walked in and you've been working for the devil, God says, if you call upon my name, you will be saved. If you call upon it in sincerity and in truth. So the question is, have you received that salvation that God desires you to have? In other words, admit you're a sinner. Repent of your sins. Means to turn away from them and go towards God. Believe in Jesus and that he raised from the dead. Confess it with your mouth and call upon his name. So you can be saved mentally, physically, emotionally, and spiritually. God wants you to be whole. Did you know that? He doesn't want you to just get saved of your soul. He wants you to be whole. The Jews always understood that. So back to our question, what are you trying to prove to God? Are you trying to prove to God how good you can be? Are you trying to prove to God that you can show up? And that's important because we need to be together and help one another. But are you trying to prove to God that you can come in on his terms before he helps you? Stop it. Humbly let him draw you in. Amen. Let God prove himself to you in 2024. When you're at the hardest day of your life, when you're under the biggest gun, when you're being under the greatest amount of pressure, stop going it alone. Go with God. Let him prove himself to you. I don't know why, but I will share this real quick. Years ago, when we were in Monument, our first little church we led, and we got down to where we had like no food in the cupboards, and the refrigerator looked like I was a bachelor. It had basically nothing in it, because all good bachelors have no food. Anyways, but we had three toddlers. We had three kids. We had basically no food in the house, and we didn't tell a soul. And I don't remember really making a big deal of it in prayer, because the Lord told me years ago, if you'll do what I ask you to do, I will take care of you. You may get income with other people's names on it, but it's I who is causing them to give it to you and sign those paychecks. So anyways, the next morning we get up, and we didn't know. We had no idea what was going on. Next morning, we get up. We open our door that goes out to where we parked, and we had one of those little porches on the end of a double wide.
and it was absolutely packed with groceries. And then one of the guys in the church, he's like, Pastor, that's the way he talked. Pastor, how much meat you got in your freezer? Well, I was used to being the guy with the money that would give stuff, not the guy that would receive stuff. So it was super awkward. So I didn't answer him. I found another something else to talk about. So he goes over to Becky and he goes, Becky, do I have permission to come to your house and look in your freezer? She goes, sure, if you want to. Oh, he got indignant because we were down to nothing, right? He's like, don't you ever let that happen again. Well, he owned literally his land is 4 miles by 6 miles, and there's an extra house on the hill, and there's a lot of cattle and a lot of land. Next thing I know, he shows back up. He goes home. He says, I'll be right back. And he shows up, and he stuffs our freezer full, and he put a whole bunch of stuff in our lay-down freezer that was in the barn that was half empty. The other, what was in it, was stuff that belonged to the person that owned the freezer, but we got the top half. They had the bottom because they asked us to do that. And all I'm telling you is this. I don't know what your need is right now. I don't know whether it's a healing. I don't know whether it's a word of wisdom or word of knowledge. I know some of you need a healing, but maybe you need something more important than that. I don't know. But let me tell you something. God wants to give you what you need, not what you want. He does listen to your prayers, but he's more interested in what you need than what you want. And how do I know that? Because he demonstrated it a whole bunch of times. Not only that, but when they would ask Jesus questions in the Bible, he would answer them what they needed to hear. He didn't answer them based on what they asked. Because you know what? You may be talking to somebody that only has 10 seconds left in their life, and you make the foolish thought, please don't get me wrong about that, but you think, I need to tell them this, this, and this. Put your hat on straight. When what they need to hear is, God loves you exactly like you are right now. Amen? So let's be the fragrance of God. And hey, and thank you for hanging out with me. I know some of you probably are uncomfortable. You've been sitting in the chair a long time, and we should have got up and did calisthenics. You need that in your life. At least I do. Stand with me. Let's pray. Those of you who are coming to the Amplify meeting, we're having lunch back there. The rest of y'all got to figure out what you're doing. Anyways, God, just thank you for today. Lord, I didn't realize how tired and sore I would be because I wasn't willing to take a muscle relaxer after my fall because I wanted to have a brain this morning. But God, it's worth it. Because Lord, being clear about who you are is more important than being comfortable. Kneeling before you is more important than the pain. Raising my hands before you is more important than the pain. So God, I pray this. I pray that you had your way today. I pray that you blessed your kids today. I pray that those who needed something from you got what they needed. I pray for those that are dealing with diagnosis that scares people to death would get a fresh infusion of the blood of Christ flowing through their body, bringing the healing they need. Way beyond what medical science can do. And I pray that their doctors would acknowledge the miracles that you're doing in that. And God, I thank you for the healing you've given me. I thank you for my future healing. And God, I thank you for this. I thank you that I get to serve you. You know it is an honor and a privilege. And you know how much I don't deserve it, but you let me do it anyways. And God, I pray that everyone in this room will get to go 100 or 1,000 times beyond anything you ever let me do. Because at the end of the day, it's not whether we were in first place. It's whether we did what you wanted. And all the people you want to save get saved. So God, please have your way in that. And send us out with safety and your help. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. God bless you. Thank you for coming. Thank you for being here. Love you guys. Try to be good. I know for some of you that hurts, because it does for me.